Football is by far the world's most popular sport, partly because it can be played in just about any location. Amateurs, right up to professionals, can train or play the game they love with simple, basic utilities such as a marked out pitch and goalposts.
In sharp contrast, facilities for spectators have evolved from small makeshift wooden stands into extravagantly large and expensive stadium arenas, requiring dozens of support facilities and highly developed infrastructure access. The Brazilian government's massive public spending on developing facilities and infrastructure for hosting the 2014 World Cup and 2016 Olympic Games was a major contributing factor to the rise in popularity of the Change Brazil movement. Many Brazilians feel that their country's health, education, policing, social care, and transport systems were all badly neglected by their government in favor of delivering the planet's two largest sporting events. It is the purpose of this documentary to explore the planning and public spending activities for the 2014 World Cup. We will also attempt to answer the question of whether or not Brazil had the capability to host a major tournament in a way that would have a beneficial impact on Brazil's economy and its 200 million citizens. West Germany held the World Cup in 1974. Although victorious on the pitch, the tournament was a major economic loss. Germany's 2006 tournament was deemed to be a great success, with FIFA, the local organizing committee, and German Football Association all reporting profits. Unanticipated ticket sales led to €20 million in unexpected revenue. Bundesliga clubs are amongst the most successful, wealthiest and best followed in the world, and yet fans own 51% of each club. Long-term planning and legislation has empowered fan-based investors to prohibit their clubs from inheriting non-club-related debts and prioritize low regular ticket prices, which helps guarantee high match attendance. German football clubs are essentially self-sustaining. When the German Football Association approached clubs to act as host venues, there was no shortage of capable applicants. 7 stadiums out of 12 were newly built, and the remainder were refurbished at a cost of €1.4 billion. Good planning and utilization of infrastructure, along with a shared 40% private and 60% government spend on all necessary World Cup related construction works, led to the ultimate success of Germany's World Cup. The World Cup in South Africa in 2010 was a very different story from the German experience in 2006. Promises of significant private funding for facilities and infrastructure projects never materialized. Grant Thornton estimated that about €3.9 billion of public money, or 6% of South African GDP, was spent on World Cup projects. An IDASA report published in 2010 outlined how a construction boom temporarily lifted the country out of the depression left in the wake of the 2008 worldwide economic crisis. However, this temporary boost to the economy ended months before the World Cup even began. 130,000 construction workers were let go by their employers, foreign construction consortiums who had won government tenders to design, manage, and build the World Cup facilities and some infrastructure. According to KPMG, just 22% of African companies benefited directly from the World Cup. Of the 12 World Cup stadiums, 4 of the largest were left without popular sporting club tenants or sustainable events, and were left to be maintained by the government at a cost of around €2 million per year per stadium. The estimated boost to the economy attributed to the World Cup was 2.7 billion, leaving a public deficit of 1.2 billion euro.
Although it is clear that South Africa and Germany's World Cup experiences were very different, it's less obvious why that was. Certainly, the differing ratios between public and private expenditure was a key factor. To determine if Brazil had the capability to host a World Cup, we should start by looking at the country's World Cup preparations.
In 2003, FIFA indicated that the 2014 World Cup would be a South American one, in accordance with their continent rotation system. Brazil's president Lula da Silva and Ricardo Teixeira, president of the Brazilian Football Confederation, CBF, were convinced that Brazil would win FIFA's hosting bid. Grand plans for new infrastructure and facilities were conjured up, but there was no evidence of a strategic bid.
Only the right, but the responsibility.
In October 2007, Brazil was formally awarded the World Cup after Colombia withdrew their bid.
Brazil!
Some have suggested that FIFA's normal criteria were waived to allow Brazil's bid to win the hosting right. FIFA's hosting agreement outlined that a local organising committee, hereby referred to as the organisers, be set up and overseen by themselves and the CBF. FIFA would have supreme control over the organisers, including approval and final choice of host cities, all football matters, and oversee drug testing. Controversially, FIFA would retain all commercial rights related to World Cup 2014, which generates the largest amount of revenue, yet the organisers would be liable for all eventualities and losses related to the tournament.
Assuming that the winning 2007 bid was conceived as a formality and not as a viable strategic plan, the primary job of the organisers would have been to select suitable World Cup host cities for Brazil 2014. The idea should be to make use of as many of Brazil's existing transport infrastructure and stadium assets as possible and limit public expenditure. A detailed analysis and understanding of Brazil's domestic football clubs, transport infrastructure, FIFA requirements, and football facilities will be crucial in this process. These are the criteria which we will be analysing in our own Brazilian World Cup host city evaluation. It is important to note that in 2007, these activities were well behind schedule. Let's start our evaluation with domestic football.
Club popularity is the most important factor in stadium financial sustainability. An eye-opening survey of domestic football popularity in Brazil was undertaken by Plurai Consultancy in 2013. The survey revealed that 20% of all Brazilians do not support domestic football. The 14 largest and wealthiest clubs in Brazil are supported by a massive 71% of all Brazilians. These clubs are located primarily in the southeast and in the bordering northeastern states of Bahia and Pernambuco. Clubs in these areas account for a further 1-2% in popularity. Shockingly, less than 8% of Brazilians support clubs located in all of the other parts of Brazil combined. The largest club, Flamengo, in Rio de Janeiro on the southeast coast, accounts for 16%, or approximately 33 million Brazilian supporters. Popularity equals money, and so based on the figures from the survey, the top 14 clubs in Brazil were all capable of generating enough private financing within 5 years to develop home grounds that would meet FIFA World Cup standards.
Unlike buses or taxis, metro or light rail systems such as this one reduce road traffic, and can accommodate significant increases in passenger numbers outside of rush hours. Existing metros can service stadiums directly or via shuttle buses, operating from strategic traffic-free locations. Both Germany and South Africa upgraded or built new metro systems for their World Cup host cities. Surprisingly, neither Germany nor South Africa's rail improvements were born out of World Cup requirements, but actually corresponded with their local government's long-term city planning goals. Germany's 12 host cities all had metro systems in place before bidding for the 2006 World Cup. In May 2010, the Passenger Rail Agency of South Africa proudly declared that all 10 of South Africa's World Cup venues were within 5 minutes walking distance from the nearest train station. Back in 2007, 11 cities in Brazil had functioning metros, or metro construction projects, half of which were located in the southeast. 6 of the 7 functional metros had impressive daily riderships of between 150,000 and 2.8 million passengers.
Highways are essentially the veins and arteries of a country that keeps life flowing within it. In 2007, 95% of passenger traffic in Brazil utilized the highways and main roads, 200,000 kilometers of which were paved. Abuse by heavy goods vehicles, which transport 65% of Brazil's freight, have for decades been causing critical levels of traffic congestion and road damage. Highways in the southeast are the most developed in Brazil. The southeast highways, unlike other regional routes, span relatively short distances between major cities, which guarantees regular usage and maintenance. Growing numbers of privatized roads requires car users to pay tolls of around 10 euro per 100 kilometers. Brazil's road infrastructure could be compared to South Africa's, a country that needed to spend a lot of public and private money on road construction and repairs for their World Cup. Germany had very little to worry about for their 2006 bid because they have had some of the best roads in the world since the 1930s.
Intercity and commuter trains are the most efficient means of transporting people between World Cup host cities. Both Germany and South Africa boasted highly developed train infrastructure in their World Cup bids. In contrast, Brazil's rapidly privatizing railroads have significantly declined in size since the 1960s and are now in a stagnant state of growth. Operating freight rail is much more profitable and less complicated than passenger services, with passenger routes accounting for less than 3,000 kilometers of tracks in Brazil. The southeast region contains almost all of Brazil's passenger trains. In 2005, Dilma Rousseff, the current president, was the Brazilian chief minister. She revived a mothball project to build a high-speed, low-fare train to connect Rio and Sao Paulo by rail in time for the 2014 World Cup. Rousseff insisted the private industry would fiercely compete to build and operate this World Cup legacy train. Critics pointed out that the bullet train or train bala project was only feasible if it was funded and developed by government. The completed train system could then be operated by either a state rail agency or private company. The Brazilian government's controversial 1998 decision to privatize railroads had jeopardized their hard-earned railway knowledge and capabilities, lucrative freight revenue, and critically, their future involvement in developing and implementing passenger rail infrastructure, such as the train bala.
Brazil's ports provide the second biggest access point for non-South Americans entering Brazil. Brazil has 10 large ports capable of berthing cruise ships, although not all of these ports have passenger terminals to process tourists. Santos in Sao Paulo is still the biggest and busiest container port in Latin America. In 2007, Santos and Rio in the southeast could process a combined total of 38.7 million passengers annually. Public investment should be reserved for improving transport infrastructure access to Brazil's economically precious container ports. Picking a port city as a World Cup host is a great prospect because any improvements made will benefit the economy long after the cruise ship sets sail for home.
Airports and air traffic management are major contributing factors to the success of a World Cup, because nearly all of the foreign fans, dignitaries and participants fly to the host country.
Increasing the volume of internal flights during a World Cup should be avoided, as airports and air traffic control management can easily become overloaded with the simultaneous influx of intercontinental and intercity passenger traffic. It is a good idea to choose World Cup host cities located in proximity to a major international airport. It is also very important that the host city and airport are connected via good quality road and rail infrastructure. Brazil has the second highest number of airstrips in the world, including over 40 commercial airports. Brazil's two major international airports are located on the southeast coast, Galeão in Rio de Janeiro and Guarulhos in São Paulo. About 80% of traffic, or 25 million passengers a year from outside of South America, pass through these two airports. Major airports must be upgraded for a World Cup, but upgrading or building regional airports is not advisable because the airport requirements generally become surplus after the tournament finishes. This happened in South Africa in 2010, when about €200 million of public money was spent on upgrading regional airport capacities for the World Cup.
All of these airports returned to normal after the tournament had ended, and the capacity upgrades provided little or no benefit to the South African people, who were left to pay the bill. Although many airports in Germany were also upgraded for their 2006 World Cup, each airport's management company contributed the majority of funding to carry out those works. Hosting a World Cup or Olympics requires excellent transport infrastructure. We have discovered that with the exception of the Southeast region and parts of the Northeast, Brazil is a country majorly deficient in modern infrastructure, especially road and rail infrastructure. The Institute for Applied Economic Research predicted in their 2025 forecast that €82 billion would need to be used to upgrade road infrastructure alone. Brazil's President Lula da Silva's 2007 PAC Growth Acceleration Program was never viable due to problems with Brazilian government processes and legislation, which we will identify later on. Like with the 1950 World Cup, the feasible option in 2007 for hosting the World Cup in 2014 and the Olympics in 2016 was to upgrade existing infrastructure in the southeast, where it's best. We now need to determine where events will take place and what facilities should be used, renovated, or built if warranted. Brazil is not short of stadiums, but most are outdated and built around terraces and concrete tiered rows for sitting. FIFA World Cup venues must have an all-seated capacity, as stated by FIFA's strict health and safety requirements. The Estádio Maracanã in Rio is the largest all-seater capacity stadium in Brazil. The stadium underwent a major renovation in 2005, but would need to be effectively rebuilt for the World Cup and Olympics. Maracanã's location, capabilities, and symbolic status makes it the only logical host venue for both the 2014 World Cup final and the Olympic Games opening and closing ceremonies in 2016. We now need to finalise where the other host venues should be located. For this, we will use the host city evaluation charts. FIFA specified that the 2014 World Cup host country must provide between 8 and 12 host cities and venues. Like with South Africa in 2010, an allowance for one host city to have two venues was made. This meant that the organisers could choose to have 8 host cities and 9 venues. This would be the most economically beneficial solution, requiring less resources, whilst maximising revenue. Brazil's organisers supplied 18 host candidates. Club popularity and infrastructure assets are the most important criteria for selecting our host cities. I have completed the host evaluation charts, and we must now try to eliminate as many of the failed criteria shaded red and orange. When we do this, we get a result of São Paulo, Belo Horizonte, Rio de Janeiro, Florianópolis, Porto Alegre, Curitiba in the southeast, the capital Brasilia in the center, Recife
and Salvador
in the northeast. I have added Santos as it is a very attractive host city choice. In 2007, picking any 8 of these 10 host cities represented the lowest public spending risk to host the World Cup in Brazil in 2014.
A similar evaluation may or may not have taken place in 2007, when the organisers and Brazilian government still had 7 years to prepare. The Brazilian government was being heavily influenced by the organisers, led by CBF President Ricardo Teixeira. For years, Teixeira had gifted Brazil's President Lula da Silva with the national team to act as goodwill ambassadors for da Silva's foreign affairs policies. In return, Teixeira was essentially granted unwavering political support from President da Silva and Sports Minister Orlando Silva Jr. Teixeira envisaged a very large tournament encompassing all of Brazil, whilst many on the organising committee and in opposition government wanted a much more conservative tournament. A host city decision had still not been reached by April 2009, so FIFA intervened and proposed 8 host cities and venues to the organisers. Teixeira somehow managed to successfully lobby FIFA to accept his counter-proposal of 12 host cities. The World Cup would now be held in São Paulo, Rio de Janeiro, Belo Horizonte, Porto Alegre, Curitiba in the southeast, Salvador, Natal, Recife and Fortaleza in the northeast, Brasilia in the centre, Cuiabá in the west, and Manaus in the northwest.
The organizers' selection of host cities was nothing short of catastrophic, with a third of them failing every single one of our host city criterion. When construction projects commenced in 2010, the organizers' promise of 90 to 100% private funding for World Cup venues was laughable, when you consider the 5 of the host cities lack major football clubs. In fact, by 2010, securing private funding for first-choice World Cup venues had become problematic.
Corinthians FC surprisingly took over as Sao Paulo City's World Cup host in late 2010 after Sao Paulo FC failed to make financial guarantees and withdrew. Corinthians were given barely 3 years to raise funds and build a world-class stadium for the tournament, an impossible task for the club in such a short time frame. The government were forced to subsidise half of the accelerated construction programme. It is without a doubt that Corinthians, the second most popular Brazilian club and 16th most valuable football club in the world, could have developed a new facility over 7 years without any state support. In fact, none of Brazil's World Cup stadiums were 100% privately funded. Many officials said that the stadiums were good investments for the economy, yet temporary hospitality facilities installed by the government were removed after the World Cup. Hospitality facilities, such as food and drink vendors, are vital long-term contributors to the sustainability of a stadium and its local economy. So what does the future hold for these venues? The sustainability of a stadium relies on regularly filling every one of its seats. In just 3 years, Brazil's government spent approximately €5,000 on each of the staggering 598,752 stadium seats for the 2014 World Cup. The Arena de São Paulo, or Itacarão, is the new home of Corinthians FC, Brazil's second most popular club. Although privately owned, the government subsidized half of Itacarão's €320 million cost with tax credits. Despite this, the Itacarão is a very good investment for the state of São Paulo. Corinthians games regularly attracted more than the 37,000 capacity of its previous home ground. When the temporary World Cup seating is removed, Itacarão has a very achievable capacity of 48,000. Taxes paid by Corinthians over the next 10 years is guaranteed to recoup all of the government's money, and Itacarão is destined to inject money into the economy for decades to come. In contrast, the unnecessary renovation of the Estadio Castelão in Fortaleza cost €200 million in government funding. It is home to Ceará and Fortaleza, clubs ranking 20th and 21st in popularity. Neither club's league games attract even a third of Castelão's 60,000 capacity. Even if capacity is reduced, Castelão and at least four other state-owned facilities will drain public money for the rest of their lives. The new Allianz Parque, home to Palmeiras in São Paulo, was 100% privately funded, but was amazingly excluded as a World Cup venue. The stadium could have been finished by late 2013. In addition to venue problems, the World Cup was plagued with disastrous infrastructure planning. Just two of the four city metro projects were fully or partially completed. Light rail projects in host cities were abandoned or substituted for expensive and poorly planned short-term solutions. A prime example of this was Belo Horizonte's rapid transit bus system, which missed the World Cup deadline, and the rush to finish it for the semi-final led to a fatal bridge collapse, killing two people. In total, 50 deaths and several hundred injuries can be linked to rushed World Cup infrastructure and stadium construction. The bullet train between São Paulo and Rio has been delayed until at least 2020, with fresh indecision over train technologies. The Trembala's total implementation costs now stand at €10 billion. Planned surfacing upgrades to public highways were postponed because tarmac supplies couldn't reach their destination due to Brazil's underdeveloped rail infrastructure. Increasing numbers of roads and highways have been privatized with higher toll rates. 8 of the 13 airports upgraded for the World Cup were not fully functional throughout the tournament. Even with airport capacity increases, the stress on air transport was unnecessarily high because FIFA did not group stadiums. Some English supporters who attended their country's group games accumulated over 30 hours in Brazilian airspace and airports. The police and military exclusion zones and daily diversions of buses in host cities during the World Cup prevented many Brazilians from moving around or working during matches, costing the economy millions. There have been indications that the diversion of and strain on utilities, such as electricity, waterworks, gas, and communications, caused significant damage requiring expensive public repair work. At the heart of Brazil's World Cup problems lies public expenditure. Unusually, Brazil does not see public procurement as a business or administrative task. It is mostly legal experts who manage government procurement, because tendering procedures in Brazil have evolved to an absurd level of legal complexity. Further inefficiency can be attributed to an unnecessary level of congressional oversight, which massively delays government projects. These issues, along with the 20-year knowledge gap in completing major public works, meant that many of Brazil's recent public projects needed to be simplified or abandoned. Rather than make the necessary reforms, Brazil's government took 10 steps backwards in 2011. An emergency procurement law for expediting the release of reconstruction funds after natural disasters, called the New Differential Procurement Regime, or RDC, was modified and adopted by Brazil's government for medium and large World Cup and Olympic procurements. RDC was completely unsuitable for this purpose or any logical procurement. RDC's undisclosed valuation goes against Brazil's constitution, which states that the valuation of a contract must be disclosed to avoid corruption from officials leaking contract valuations to select groups. RDC tender specifications are written by the bidding suppliers, a stipulation which allows Brazil's government to essentially buy what they want for the World Cup and Olympics without correctly planning for or understanding the procurement. Very few organizations have the capability to plan government tender specifications, meaning large multinationals have a monopoly on RDC contracts, and all 5.8 million SMEs in Brazil, or 93% of companies, are effectively excluded from World Cup and Olympic procurement. That is exactly what happened in 2013 when the Corinthians Stadium in Brasilia needed stadium support equipment. The government enacted RDC law, and a subsidiary of the United Nations won the contract to oversee supply of equipment, with Brazilian companies getting only a small slice of the contract. This is just one example of several large RDC World Cup contracts, including many airport construction and management contracts, which unnecessarily left Brazil. London in 2012 was a very good example of how to include local businesses in public procurement. The Olympic organisers outsourced procurement to a British-based consortium. The organisers planned and oversaw all procurement activities, but the consortium, with its manpower and expertise, managed all procurement processes, making them so efficient that SMEs and even sole traders could apply for contracts via a simple one-page online form. Brazil's ineffective RDC law, sustainable procurement, and lowest price award criteria procurement processes allowed significant amounts of public money to be wasted on World Cup and Olympic-related projects. FIFA and the Brazilian economy look likely to have benefited almost equally, with an estimated gross of 4 and 4.7 billion euro respectively. However, the Brazilian government spent at least 10 billion euro, leaving a staggering loss of over 5 billion euro, which is by far the greatest direct financial loss in World Cup history. Brazil's economy went into recession in the second quarter of 2014. If the winners of our host city evaluation chart had been chosen, 8 of these cities with 9 venues would likely have hosted an economically beneficial World Cup for Brazil and its citizens. This documentary has identified potential planning and public spending errors made by the World Cup 2014 organisers, including possible failures to formulate a viable strategic bid, strategically assess and utilise existing infrastructure assets in Brazil's football clubs in the selection of host cities, correctly balance public and private expenditure, make logical host city and venue choices in the time available, optimize the scale of the tournament, and group host city stadiums. We have also shown how the Brazilian government's problematic procurement, political, administrative, and legal systems contributed to poor decision-making and massively reduced the World Cup's benefits to the economy by wrongly facilitating organisers to dictate what the Brazilian government spent on the World Cup. Century mega sporting events have drained the public funds of Japan, South Korea, Greece, China, South Africa, Poland, Ukraine, United Kingdom, Russia, and Brazil. Countries that avoided large public spending include Portugal, Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. With risk, challenges, complexities, and costs equal to natural disasters and war, mega sporting events must be simplified to benefit their host nations and citizens. UEFA have taken a groundbreaking step in the right direction by restructuring the European Football Championships in 2020.
The matches of the Euro will be split into 13 packages.
Dividing up the tournament removes the enormous burden and risks associated with one nation hosting the tournament, whilst also giving smaller nations their first chance to actively participate and benefit. FIFA, the Olympic Organization, and IRB have shown no signs of changing their tournament formats, with no shortage of countries willing to bid as hosts.
I think 2023 is going to be the right time for Ireland.
Ireland's ambitious 2023 or 2027 Rugby World Cup cross-border hosting bid has already committed the Irish government to fully underwrite the tournament and fund six GAA stadium renovations at a combined cost of around 400 million euro. The cost to upgrade infrastructure, non-GAA stadiums, media and hospitality facilities, and carry out all other works for the tournament is still unclear. However, under the IRB hosting agreement, the Irish government would be obligated to finish all of the tournament-related works, regardless of the final cost. That final cost to Irish taxpayers for planning and delivering a Rugby World Cup could easily exceed the estimated revenue of just 1 billion euro from tourism and business activities. Correctly balancing public and private expenditure will be crucial to an economically successful Rugby World Cup in Ireland. But like with Brazil 2014, the enormous risk to the Irish government is far greater than the limited financial rewards and nationalistic pride the tournament guarantees.
If successful, Euro 2020 may mark the beginning of the end for the elitist host nation and may pave the way for more practical and inclusive sports competitions that positively impact multiple host countries on a level never seen before.